Hello students, welcome to EPG Pathshala. In this module, we shall be discussing traditional methods of waste collection and disposal. In previous two modules, you have learnt about what is solid waste and you have learnt about classification of solid waste. You have also learnt about different sources of solid waste. You know that if solid waste is allowed to remain littered in our streets or near our habitations, then it is going to harm our environment in a very bad way. Means this can affect our water bodies, this can affect our air, this can affect our soil. Means it can, if waste remain littered, it can affect any component or any matrix of the environment. As far as waste collection and disposal is concerned, waste collection and waste disposal is an important part of any solid waste management plan. In this module, we shall be learning about traditional methods of waste collection and disposal. The learning objectives of this module are to understand the problems of waste generation, to identify the need for waste collection, to identify various waste disposal methods used in earlier times or in older times. The problem of waste generation is as old as the advent of human life. With time, there has been evolution in the living pattern of humans, and so has in the quantity and quality of the waste generation. Earlier, the kind of waste generation was mainly biodegradable, but gradually the waste have transformed to recalcitrant and toxic. During prehistoric times, human lived in a group like nomad, and the waste they generated were degraded by the scavengers. The waste such as weapons, bones and stone tools, these were non-biodegradable in nature, never accumulated to the level to pose problem. Means their number was very, very less. The general methods employed for the management and disposal of waste were open dumping. Open dumping, you all know, is still practiced widely as it is easy and cheap method, but this is not a recommended method and this is very harmful to the environment. That we will be discussing later on in other modules. During ancient civilization, there was no organized waste management system. People used to litter waste anywhere, and in case of odor problem, they covered the waste with clay or soil. The early history of waste dumping system can be traced back to 500 BC in Greece, where people first created town dump. The Greeks by law were directed to dump waste 1 mile from the city. So we can say that even our earlier forefathers, they were concerned about the wastewater disposal and wastewater collection. During same times when Greeks recommended making of town dumps, Athene law prohibited littering of waste on the streets. Similarly, the Egyptian, on the other hand, they dumped garbage in the river Nile. Today we know that how problematic it is for the river system, this disposal of solid waste in the rivers. During 2nd century BC, the Chinese people had systematic workforce for organized cleaning of major cities. The Mayans, you know, that was a highly developed civilization. So the Mayans in ancient times had proper waste disposal system where they had special dumps for organic waste and reused material like broken earthen pots. Industrial revolution accompanied major changes in waste quality and quantity. Europe in 18th and 19th century saw widespread occurrence of epidemics, and that was due to industrial waste and human waste. Means waste were not disposed properly, they accumulated and ultimately led to spreading of number of epidemics. The Americans generally collected waste in huge bags and dumped in the sea. And today we know that disposal of waste in sea is how dangerous. Now the question arises, What is the need for waste collection? Effects of improper collection or no collection of solid waste from the environment. Effects on human health. Organic constituents of solid waste have tendency to degrade easily and during the process creates foul odor because of release of various gases. You know that when the degradation takes place of the waste, other than oxidation, then several toxic gases like ammonia, H2S, PH3, etc. are produced and they are toxic as well as odorous. The accumulated organic solid waste draw disease-causing vectors such as insects, pests and rodents. This is a common sight in India, in the outskirts or at illegal solid waste disposal places, that stray animals commonly visit those places and that may lead to spreading of diseases. The diseases such as typhoid, cholera are spread by such vectors. If the waste is not disposed properly, it can enter water bodies and cause contamination or may block even the drainage system. This may also promote the growth of mosquitoes and in overall, improper disposal, improper collection or no collection of solid waste threaten human health. Let me try to learn that what are the effects of improper collection or no collection of solid waste on the environment. The improper handling and management of waste badly affects the physical environment. The contaminants of solid waste pollute water bodies, soil and air, or we can say all the matrices of environment. The open burning of solid waste lead to air pollution that cause health problems. Subsequently, distresses the sustainability of the environment. This also affects the aesthetic aspects of the area. Solid waste, if not properly disposed, may affect the physical appearance of any locality. Littering of waste on street spoils the scenic beauty of environment as a whole. This also has effects on the economic growth of any society, any city, any nation. Cleaner cities will invite tourists and private investments that help in creating more job opportunities and provide satisfactory services to its citizens. Thus, proper solid waste management through improved waste collection facilities can overcome all above ill effects which we have just now discussed. Let me have a look on the street cleaning scenario. In addition to the waste generated on the premises, waste is also generated along the roadsides and streets. The waste presents in streets include natural waste. Natural waste is the waste that is blown from adjoining open spaces. This street waste also contains behavioral waste. Behavioral waste is the waste deposited by pedestrians and people using the streets. Waste from residences is often thrown by roadsides. Waste generated on road, such as accidental spillages from loaded vehicles, construction and demolition waste, animal droppings, cow dung, etc., oil spillage from vehicles and rubber during traffic congestion. The waste generated from nearby residential, commercial and industrial areas. In addition to that, street waste contains a lot of inert matter also. You know that Indian streets are not, means many Indian streets are not metalled. So, when we do the sweepings, that time some of the earth material that is inert in nature may also add it to the street waste. Now, the waste generated by the roadside industrial areas. Waste generated by the roadside vegetables and fruit vendors, street hawkers and slum dwellers. Sweepers generally clean only major streets and drainage and avoid narrow street lanes. They also don't stop at each and every doorstep to collect waste. Although this practice has been started now in many Indian cities, but still the waste is not collected door to door in the rural areas. The sweeping is carried out manually by using shorthand brooms, although there is a perceptible trend towards use of longhand brooms. Only major roads are swept every day, while the minor roads are swept once in a week or once in 2 weeks, like that. The manual cleaning work is usually carried out commonly, that is, one person sweeping the road and another will collect the waste material in a handcart. They work in two shifts, from 6 to 12 in the morning in the first shift and 3 to 5 in the evening in the second shift. They work on 6 days a week. The lack of manpower and insufficiently available fund prove to be inefficient in dealing with street sweepings. Means if we want proper street sweepings, we have to provide more finances as well as we have to provide more manpower and better equipments to have our streets clean. Now let me come to the traditional waste disposal methods. In the 20th century, humans have dealt with solid waste in three basic ways. One is by burning the waste. Burning the waste results in generation of ash and release of gases and smoke to the environment by storing. So when we use this burning of the waste, we are doing nothing. We are just changing the phase. Earlier the pollution was present in the solid form. Now the ash that is already that remains in the solid form, and the gases which have gone to the air, they pollute our ambient air. So this is not a recommended method. Second method is by storing the waste. This includes the leftover ash from burning in dumps, impoundments, and by injecting or by burying waste in rock cavities deep underground. This is the third method. This is a method that is proposed for the disposal of industrial and conventional toxic or hazardous waste. So generally three methods are used. One is by the burning, second is one by the storage, and third one is by the injecting or burying the waste in the rock cavities. These are the three methods generally employed. The following methods are used generally for disposal of solid waste: open burning of waste, incineration of waste at low temperature in an uncontrolled manner is said to open burning. Although it is a traditional method of waste management practiced by major population very commonly of the country, but it is not proper method of waste management. It reduces the quantity of waste. Around 40% of the worldwide solid waste is eliminated by open burning. In developing countries particularly, it is widely practiced because it is an easy, cheap and effective way to get rid of solid waste. So here you have to understand that by the burning, we don't do any management of the waste, we just get rid of solid waste. Generally, open burning is carried out near the dumping site as it reduces the cost of transportation. Burning of solid waste leads to an air pollution that in turn helps in heating up of earth also. It has been scientifically proved that open burning releases harmful gases and causes soil and water pollution. I have seen in the literature several studies have been carried out on the environmental pollution caused by the different waste disposal sites or so called landfill sites in the major cities, Delhi, Bombay, Madras, etc. So I will suggest the student, please just put in the Google that the studies on the waste or the studies on the waste studies on the effects of solid waste disposal in the major cities of India, you will find very eye-opening studies over there. Then dumping of solid waste. One of the most common traditional method of waste disposal is dumping of solid waste. The waste is first cleared from the source of generation and dumped in specified location in such a way that it doesn't cause any serious implication to the humans and the environment. Nowadays, urban local bodies called as ULBs have approved the dumping of waste as mean of waste disposal. It is the responsibility of local association to ensure that the waste is safely disposed within its jurisdiction. In present scenario, there is no systematic or scientifically organized method for the treatment of waste. The open dumping results in building of unhygienic conditions around the dumping site. The mismanaged dumping sites pose serious threat to the environment and public health. Let me have a look on the waste dumping practices used in the major cities of India. Let me come to Bengaluru. Bengaluru is a very fast developing city of India, you all know it. The waste is commonly dumped openly. The city consists of nearly 14 open dumping sites where the wastes are piled in heaps without any treatment. It has two composting plants with the capacity of about 220.4 tons and 330.6 tons of waste respectively, but only 1/3 of their waste handling capacity is used. If we come to the Kolkata, in Kolkata, the waste is disposed by open dumping. It has around 14 open dumping disposal sites. About 10 metric tons to 500 metric tons of solid waste is dumped in these sites. This table shows the prominent dumping sites. I don't know whether I should call them open dump or landfill. You please look on their pictures and decide yourself whether these are open dumping sites or landfill sites. So this table shows the prominent dumping sites in major cities in India. We have taken these dumping sites from Mumbai, Delhi, Chennai and Bangalore. In Mumbai, there are several dumping sites and they are Deonar dump site, then Mulund and Kunjur Marg dump sites. This Deonar, a number of times this is in news because there is constant fire and large smoke is generated over there that affect the environment and the visibility in that area. Please have a look, put this Deonar Mumbai in the Google and you will find a number of pictures and news items which have appeared about this. Nearly 50% of the total waste dumped in Mumbai is generated in Mumbai is dumped at Deonar dump site. If we come to Delhi, in Delhi we have several waste dump sites and these are at Okhla, Ghazipur, Narela Bhavana and Bhalsawa. These dumping sites cover total area of about 150 acres. Recently, one of the dump site in Delhi was in news because the mountain of the garbage, solid waste, that was broken and that ultimately led to the death of two people. Please search about this also on internet. Then in Chennai also, we have Kondugayur and Perungudi waste disposal sites. Similarly, in Bangalore, we have Mandar, Bingipura and Lakshmipura solid waste disposal sites. So, dear student, I'll suggest you please make a list of the different waste disposal sites in the country and try to collect some data, and based upon data you please try to decide whether these are properly managed landfill sites or whether these are just open dump sites. Now, the another way that is practiced for the disposal of solid waste disposal is the dumping of waste disposal in the sea. Dumping solid waste in the sea is an age-old practice because it is easy way to get rid of waste. It is widely practiced in the coastal areas throughout the world. The waste is generally taken in the canal boat and dumped at least 15 to 30 km away from the coastline. This practice of waste disposal is quite expensive and not environment friendly. You know, every coin is having two sides, so let me try to know some of the merits of dumping of solid waste in the sea. Dumping of solid waste in the sea poses less hazard than the open burning. Coastal fisheries and communities residing beside coastline may be minimally affected due to waste dumping in the deep ocean. The assimilative capacity of ocean or sea is incredibly high, as oceans are huge. With properly organized and well-designed dumping method, waste can be collected, concentrated and disposed in deep, particularly in the confined areas in the ocean, that can cause least damage to the overall marine life. The waste dumped in ocean can be easily degraded due to abundant aeration and vast flora and fauna. It is one of the cheapest methods of waste disposal for the communities residing in the coastal area. Now, what are the demerits of sea disposal? No doubt it is economical to dump waste near the shore by the communities. By transporting and discharging waste deep in the ocean requires huge investment and well-designed system. The waste accumulated deep inside the ocean may have hidden risk in long run. In one of the investigations, it has been found that the mercury level in the whale was found to be much higher than in the ocean. That may be due to bioaccumulation. And let me give you another example of Minamata. In case of Minamata, although this was not solid waste, this was liquid waste that was disposed in the bay, and that ultimately resulted in the accumulation of heavy metals in the fish, and then effects appeared first in the cats and then in the human beings. So similar things can happen with the solid waste also. Once the toxins are dumped in ocean, the contaminant is not ensured. If the waste dumped contain more organic matter, then it will result in the depletion of oxygen level. Once a damage is done to a particular area in the ocean, it will take very long time to restore, as the residence time of ocean is quite high. At several places, waste is disposed in the agricultural fields also. So in this case, the solid waste is generally buried into the farmer's field, and they are allowed to plow after some time. This practice is not much common and not environment friendly. To avoid ocean dumping of the solid waste, several regulations have been passed. So waste disposal without any proper planning have severely affected the oceanic life. A number of studies in this regard are available. Around 200 red tides have been experienced yearly in Japan's inland sea. In 1988, New York and New Jersey closed its beaches because of washing of medical waste and sea waste. Disposal of medical waste in the ocean is another problem. Waste dumping has severely affected fishery industry, as toxins get accumulated in the marine animals over a period of time and make them unsuitable for consumption. In 1890, Rivers and Harbor Act restricted disposal of waste in the US navigation waters. In 1978, Hughes Amendment to Ocean Dumping Ban Act prohibited sea waste dumping sludge. Pew Ocean Commission in 2003 declared set of rules for protecting the health of marine system. It mainly focused on prioritizing the ocean restoration and increasing economic return. It has doubled the investment on marine research and recommended creating a robust system of protecting marine reserves. Let me have a look on the various acts and related amendments that are related to the ocean dumping. A number of acts and have been passed in this regard. So in 1972, Marine Protection Research and Sanctuary Act was there. 1974, London Dumping Convention implementation was there. 1977, Authorization of Appropriation Act 1980 as well as 1980 Authorization of Appropriations, then 1982 Surface Transportation Assistance Act, then in 1986 Budget Reconciliation Act, in 1986 we have Water Resources Development Act, 1987 Water Quality Act, 1988 Ocean Dumping Research Amendments, then in 1990 Regional Marine Research Centers, then 1992 National Coastal Monitoring Act and Water Resources Development Act. From this table, it is evident that a number of laws have been passed at international level. Dear student, I suggest you to please have a look on the Indian laws and try to find out that what efforts have been made by the government of India to protect the oceans from pollution or from the solid waste disposal. To summarize this module, in this module, we have learnt about traditional methods of waste collection as well as we have learnt about old traditional waste disposal methods like open dumping, disposal in water bodies and open dumping methods, and we have also learnt about the open dumps of different Indian cities, and we have also learnt a bit about the ocean dumping of the waste as well as about different acts and different regulations that have been passed at international level to avoid the disposal of solid waste in the water bodies. Thank you.